anybody says, why are you shipping weapons to Iran? They can say, we're doing it to save the lives of these poor hostages.
And we know they did give them the armaments.
And they did. And that's Iran-Contra. Now, so the
hold on, we got to break again. We're going to come back and have plenty of time in the long segment. Then let's get into what happened in Mumbai. Different place, same story.
Same story, same method.
All over again, prisonplanet.com. Be sure and check it out. We'll be right back. Okay, Webster, let's get right back into how the Islamo-fascists, as the neocons like to call them, were actually put into power by Zbigniew Brzezinski and, of course, Secretary of Defense Gates at the time, who was the man handling Iran-Contra. And this is a historical fact, and you bring this up to conservatives. And I mean, I had a Special Forces guy, Black Ops guy, who's now a lawyer, you know, with the Terrorism Center, and he's saying we've got to have basically World War III because the Iranians are going to nuke us and kill us, and oh my God, the Islamo-fascists. When it's a fact that there were already these extremist Muslims, and they were energized by the West. So continue.
So the basic idea is that Brzezinski, Gates, and Carter, and Cyrus Vance, trilaterals all, overthrew the Shah. Not only did they overthrow the Shah, but they insisted on bringing in Khomeini. Not a general's coup, not this guy Bakhtiar who was around, but it had to be Khomeini, because Islamic fundamentalism was the great bulwark against Soviet communism. So after this April 1978 meeting in Algiers with Brzezinski and Yazdi, there was agreement that the U.S. is going to continue to deliver weapons, and then there's a side agreement between Brzezinski and Yazdi that nobody talks about, I believe, in which they say, all right, we're going to have a taking of hostages. And there's a lot of stuff, and I go through it, and I got a part on the Carter administration in this book. Now, the October surprise was then the freeing of the hostages, right? And the trick was to try to make sure that the hostages were not freed under Carter before November 1980, because that would have gotten Carter reelected or might have...
And then as soon as Reagan's elected, they release him.
Right. Now, there were then hearings. This guy, Gary Sick, you may remember him, Gary Sick from the State Department or wherever he was, he promoted these hearings about the October surprise. And back in my book, George Bush, The Unauthorized Biography, 1992, I read about the fact that there were lots of reports that George Bush the Elder personally flew to Paris one night in a private jet to meet with some Iranians and then come back. We know that Kissinger was reported to be negotiating with Iranians and others. Dick, whatever his name was, the other guy in the Reagan National Security Council, the thing that Barbara Honegger has written about. But now, when those hearings started, the Soviet government, Moscow, sent a whole bunch of information to the Senate committee, actually the House committee with Lee Hamilton, our dear friend Lee Hamilton, who's such a good investigator, as we know from 9/11. And it said, look, here's all the information about Robert Gates up to his neck in Iran-Contra, or what was then going to be called Iran-Contra, and above all, the October surprise. So this guy is dirty. Now, the other dimension on him is, as he writes in his own memoirs, and this I write about in 9/11 Synthetic Terror Made in USA, Gates wrote his memoirs and he said, we considered creating an Arab legion of fighters from all the Arab countries to go into Afghanistan, which is not Arab but Muslim, and fight the Soviets. But we decided not to do it. Yeah, bunk, you did decide to do it, and it's called Al-Qaeda. So Robert Gates is fighting his own illegitimate child, we might say, right? Robert Gates at the Pentagon is directing the worldwide struggle against Al-Qaeda, which he founded. And when he was named back in 2006, I put out a short release about this, saying this guy should not be the head of the Pentagon because he's the founder of Al-Qaeda.
Well, let's expand on that. They're not fighting Al-Qaeda. As we know, 5 years ago I reported, and Cy Hirsch 3.5 years ago, and then last year the White House at whitehouse.gov puts out a press release saying, we are funding pro-democracy forces. Here are the four groups in eastern Iraq into Iran, and they are these Wahhabist groups, and there was one little Kurd group tacked on, and then it turned out the guy commanding the largest group was the number three listed by the FBI, number three in Al-Qaeda, and they're staging terror attacks all over Iran, and Iran is now suing the United States for blowing up mosques, schools, police stations. And then Bush, I remember last year with Mohammed Karzai in the Rose Garden, said, We need to go into Iran because Iran is funding Al-Qaeda in Afghanistan. And Karzai, even though he's this puppet unicoil, you know, narcotics trafficker, he says, excuse me, Mr. President, because he knew this was on TV overseas. This was like saying that, you know, Spider-Man really lives or that Santa Claus is real. He said, Iran is Shiite and they're actually helping us, fight the Wahhabists, which are Sunni, and we're friends with Iran. And Bush said, no, that's not true. Iran is Al-Qaeda. And we saw many other people say this. So of course, Bush knows that's not the case. They're talking to the public like they're complete morons. And so Al-Qaeda clearly is just this catch-all for Muslim groups they don't control. But then when they have real terror attacks, it's staged. Let's now get into Mumbai.
Well, we know Obama, first of all, is the greatest Paki basher of all time. In other words, Obama is the guy who ran for president saying, I'm going to bomb the hell out of Pakistan.
And then magically the crisis appears.
Now, let me stress again, I do not believe there's going to be an attack on Iran. No, because not that I can see. I'll be very surprised, okay?
But Israel says they may go in.
I think this is a lot of bluster, and there's a negotiation going on.
But is Iran still part of this, or have they broken off from the neocons?
You look at... It's not the neocons.
Again, well, I mean, I know it's the Brzezinski.
Brzezinski is the guy.
No, I understand. It's
the difference is that
it's the Harvard PhD, but I'm
the Harvard boutique.
Yeah, it's that office. But what I'm saying is, did they break off during the neocon time? Did they break off before?
There's been a period of bad relations. Okay, but and you know, there's mass politics and other things that go into this. But right now, Obama ran on a Brzezinski platform, which is to say, I'm going to bomb and destroy Pakistan, and I'm going to negotiate with Iran. What are you going to negotiate with Iran? You're going to negotiate the terms by which Iran becomes a cat's paw for the U.S. in the Caspian Sea against the enemy to the north. And that's, of course, it's still Russia. Bust up the Baku Caspian Sea oil thing. Get an Iranian fleet in the Caspian Sea, an Iranian fleet with nuclear weapons. If you look at Brzezinski's track record, his track record is delivering very advanced military hardware.
Why did the West
Iran.
Help? Why did the West help deliver the components, England, the U.S. to Iran?
Yeah, because that was geopolitics then, and it's geopolitics now. This geostrategic, as he likes to say. Now, if you look at what Brzezinski writes, he goes as far as he can. He says, once we normalize relations between the U.S. and Iran, Iran could resume its usual role of being a positive factor in regional stability. Now, there used to be this thing called CENTO. Remember the Central Treaty Organization? I think it was Turkey, Iraq, Iran, Pakistan. It fell apart really in the 60s. It fell apart during the Vietnam War. But they'd like to get back to this. The idea would be play Iran against the Russians. Now, moving to Pakistan, this is a totally different story. The whole business in Afghanistan is now being run for one purpose and one purpose only. Break up Pakistan. Destroy it. With Iran, you want to negotiate. You'd like to have a different government, but for the moment, it's going to be a puppet. Ultimately, they're scheduled to be carved up into six or seven parts as well. But the front burner, let's say, the hot topic is Pakistan. Now, why Pakistan? Because it's a Chinese ally. It has a border with China.
And China needs the pipelines that come through it. And China has said in an Indian-Pakistan conflict, they are now siding, they said 2 days ago, with Pakistan.
Yeah, and this is a you know, long-term thing. Remember the Sino-Soviet split? India went with the Russians, but Pakistan went most decidedly with the Chinese because they have a common border. If you look at Pakistan, it goes from the Arabian Sea and it joins joins with China above India, above.
Then you've got Nepal and all that.
Yeah, but they're further away.
Down, yeah.
The main thing is that there's a common border between Pakistan and China, and there's this port, Gwadar. You gotta get rid of the old map of the Persian Gulf and get a really big Brzezinski-style map. Gwadar is this deep water port at the Arabian Sea, so it's southwest Pakistan, not so far from Iran, but above all, the Straits of Hormuz are there. So the idea with the Chinese is, if they could get tankers coming from Saudi Arabia, Iraq, Iran, from those tanker terminals, coming out of the Straits of Hormuz, they could build a pipeline that would go up Pakistan.
That's
would
the pipeline.
Go up the Indus. It's not there yet, but no,
but
it could be
but
built.
They need that. Now, let's stop. That's their only avenue except for Russia, but Russia doesn't have big terminals
and
near
there.
And it's
landlocked, because therefore you get away from the
you've also got the Himalayas, so they can't get it from Russia.
Well, you can maybe go around it. But the main thing is the Anglo-American fleets, the Anglo-American naval domination of the Persian Gulf and the Arabian Sea.
It's key to the strategy.
You want to work around that. And if you're China and you make Pakistan into your energy corridor, you can do two things. You can have a pipeline that goes directly from Iran to Pakistan to China. There you have your guaranteed oil supply with no Anglo-American air fleet anywhere near you.
And then you can develop the railways, cities, and then have China dominate the region. Now, let's stop right there because we're almost out of time, Webster. We have a little bit left in this segment and then a five-minute segment. Now, how does the Mumbai-Bombay situation play into all of this, and what is your analysis of what really happened there?
Okay. First of all, this is basically it's coming, you know, as if on cue, right? It's just when they need it. Remember, there's an Indian-U.S. nuclear accord that was approved in October. In the hurly-burly and brouhaha of the presidential campaign, we might have missed the fact that India has now become the spear point of the U.S., the British, and the Israelis in Eurasia. It's what the British used to call a continental dagger. India is a continental dagger. It's 1.2 billion pieces of cannon fodder from the point of view of the U.S., the British, and the Israelis. So the idea is to play them against China, play them against Russia, play them against Pakistan, play them to bust up any possibility of Eurasian
of a coalition.